all received for a few moments. I'm actually living through a flashback of many, many decades ago. When I was a seminarian in Rome, one of the things when you're a student in Rome, you get to go to all the papal services that you would want to, even if you didn't want to, because you're on a rotation to serve. The National Seminaries all took rotations in terms of we were the athletes and the whatnot, the gophers and the runs, in the liturgy. But one of the things I used to remark at, and I actually heard Pope Paul VI say that. He was a very old man at the time when I was a student. It was so obvious that he was so dead tired when the service would begin. And you would see him get more and more animated as the liturgy continued. And he used to say, by celebrating the liturgy, you give yourself in a sense of prayer, it energizes you. And I have to tell you, for those of you who were here before, between 8 and 9 o'clock, I've said to people, I've hit a wall, and I am so tired, but as this liturgy has developed, I'm getting more and more energy. So I'm sorry, you're going to get the whole sermon. This is the Sunday that the readings ask us to focus on what it means to bring the gospel of Jesus to others, to be missionary. Now, I have a trick question, and Ron, you're forbidden to answer it, because I suspect you know the answer. What is the name of the Episcopal Church? Its official, legal, and corporate name? The United States of America. That's the second half of the title. What's the first half of the title? In 1821, there was a special gathering of bishops, clergy, and laity. And they took upon themselves a commitment, and they changed the name of our church forever to be the Domestic and Foreign Mission Society of the Protestant Episcopal Church of the United States of America. And by doing that, they were sending a message. Whereas the Orthodox churches have mission associations, the Church of England has missions, many mission associations, the Roman Catholic Church has missionary orders, the Episcopal Church is a mission society by name. That's who we are. We are commissioned to be bearers of the good news to the world. We are missionaries. This was the one Sunday in the Roman world where you would hope you would get a real missionary to come in and talk about what he does so you get the week off from preaching. It don't happen. And that would be wrong, because there is no specially designated missionary. We're all supposed to be missionaries. We're all supposed to reflect who we are as believers in Christ, that we are believers in the death and resurrection of Jesus, and we have good news to bring to others. So what I'm going to do today very simply is kind of look at what we're supposed to be doing. What's the message? And tell us about the messengers. Okay? Here's the message, really simple. Like Paul, who, if you listen to Ron reading today, Paul actually physically wrote the letter to the Galatians. The only one where he knows, he makes a comment. See what big letters I write with? Everything else he dictated, as far as we know. But he was so mad at them, he couldn't wait for somebody to come in to dictate the letters. He wrote it himself. And he writes to them and says, look, whatever you boast about, whatever you think you are about, we boast of nothing except the cross of Christ. That being a Christian, and use all the categories you want to divide people, distinctions of rank, of physical marks that make up our ethnic origin, the thoughts that we would be immune from criticism or persecution or in our day nasty tweets. Being a Christian is not about keeping rules or being liked or winning God's approval or all those things. By the way, I just went through about 8 different heresies. being a Christian is proclaiming to the world by the way we talk and the way we live and the way we think and the way we treat each other that God is unfolding a new creation. And we're called to be a part of it. And just as the death of Jesus transformed Paul into something new and vibrant and wonderful, that should happen to us. So that's the message. But then Jesus gives them a plan. He says, this is the way you live it, okay? First and foremost, have you noticed that you can follow along in the leaflet if you want to, because I'm not making this up. You notice, first of all, he sent them out in pairs, literally two by twos. We are sent together as a community. We're never sent alone, but with others. Faith is not supposed to be a solitary experience, and bringing Christ to others is not a solitary experience, at least the way Jesus foresaw it. Because we need each other's mutual support. We need to be there for others, and we need others to be there for us, because We need encouragement because witnessing to the truth is sometimes very difficult. And we need encouragement because when you look at yourself and you're really honest and you stare back from that person that's in the mirror and you look at that person and you say, God really picked that person to do God's work? I do that all the time. It's like, God, you gotta pick somebody better. It's gotta be somebody better than you that. But the answer is no. He picked you. So we do need each other's support and encouragement because he chose you to do God's work. Secondly, he said, I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. And I am reminded there's a great line. Many of you probably, I don't know whether you like him or not. I think, whatever you think of his personal life, I think his writing ability and his comedy is genius. And that's Woody Allen. Mm-hmm. Woody Allen made a comment once about, yes, the lamb will lie down with the wolf, but the lamb will always sleep with one eye open. And that's typical Woody Allen's sarcastic humor. But the point is, being a believer in Jesus is never going to make you popular. You're never going to be loved. Whenever I hear that towns make life difficult for churches, I say, okay, we're not in the 1950s anymore. Guess what? This is the way it's supposed to be. Because unfortunately, we stand as a witness to something greater and something more important. And that may not make you a lot of friends. Jesus knew opposition. We should expect it ourselves. And our only defense is going to be the truth of Christ, and our only power is going to be the power of the Holy Spirit that fills us. He also said that wherever you go, the first thing you wish people is the peace of God. Be a person who is at peace with yourself and extend that peace to others. Despite the fact that we are going to experience the dark side from others, we must bring peace because he did. You know, we look back on it in the way of Gandhi, who wasn't a Christian, or Martin Luther King, who was, the notion of nonviolent resistance. They got it. And all the world needs to see us in the same way. He told them, don't travel too heavily. Don't be burdened with a lot of stuff. Travel lightly. Don't worry about purse or bag or sandals. You're going to be dealing with the stuff of life, but don't get entangled up in it, or you'll end up like a fish that's caught in a net. Use it. Don't be used by it. Don't become obsessed over it, because in the end, all the stuff in the world is not going to make you happy. And it's certainly not going to help you bring others to Christ. Now, when he says, greet no one on the road, he wasn't looking forward to my brother who basically talks to no one. This wasn't it about. But when he said, in the Eastern world, especially in ancient cultures, in the Eastern world, when you greeted someone, you not only extended your greeting to them, you inquired of their family. You asked about their ancestors. You went and spent a lot of time talking about their family and their family's family and your children and your children's children. And there was a whole lot of stuff you went into before you even said hello. Okay? And he's reflecting that. He said, look, in the world, long, windy, windy greetings, lots of talk may make sense, but don't linger over the silly things because I'm giving you work to do. Being Christian isn't about talk. It's about witness. It's about living the gospel and sharing that love with others. It is about the love of God and love of neighbor and serving those who need us and glorying in the cross of Christ. And the final thing I always found interesting, he says, now when you go into a town and people want to give you something to eat and take care of you, let them do it. One of the most difficult things, and this is personal, I don't want to say anything. I would stand off of the pulpit, I could, but I can't, okay? it would be interesting anyway. Yes, it needs to get full. It's hard for some people to let others be gracious to them. Mm-hmm. It's very, very difficult to let others love you. Okay? But that's part of being Christian too. That's letting others extend their hospitality, their gifts towards you. And Jesus said, look, if you're going to be a believer, and it is about serving others, it is about loving others, part of loving others is letting them reflect that love back at you. Don't be ashamed of it, and don't harump over it, and don't be grouchy over it, and now he's talking to me directly, okay? Mm-hmm. Being a believer means we allow others through our prayer and our service, and through that, to and let Christ heal a world that is just so broken, relationships that are so broken, ourselves that at times can be so broken. So, very simply, we're all part of this mission of the 70. We've all been commissioned to bring the good news to others, to serve God and neighbor. We've all been given the grace of the Spirit on the day we were baptized to be that kind of devoted follower. And when the story of our life is completed, and believe me, this week I dealt a lot and lived a lot with the reality of what happens when the story of our lives is finally written, we're told that it's never going to be a matter of pride. It isn't a matter of how much I accomplish or think I've accomplished or others think I've accomplished. It's not a matter of how much evil I've overcome personally. Jesus says, don't be glad about any of that. Don't be glad about the stuff you may have or not have. Be a person who has lived and witnessed as best as you can.